My name is Ian Nagoski. I'm a music researcher. I live in Baltimore, Maryland, in the US. For about 20 years, I've been involved in early 20th century recordings, various kinds. But about 10 years ago, I began producing reissue records of music from the early 20th century, entirely in languages other than English, which is a little strange because, as a stupid American, I only read and speak English. So I'm sorry. I will try to make myself clear and understood. I wound up specializing in recordings made by immigrants to the United States, particularly from the Near East, from Greece, Armenia, Turkey, Syria, Egypt, the end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th centuries. If you're looking at any immigrant music or ethnic minority music of that era, and you're interested in the human beings that made it, which is really what I cared about always, was dignifying the lives of people who'd been kind of left behind. Americans don't care much about immigrant culture. You wind up hearing a lot of stories over and over again of refugees and homelessness and loss and tragedy and death and murder and war and the end of empire and genocide. And after a while, it gets to be emotionally exhausting. It took its toll on me, and I developed another project which I could obsess about and which I could do research on and tell stories about and learn about that was interesting to me, that I thought would be lighter and more pleasant and sweeter as an emotional defense mechanism. I'm still working on the immigrant stuff, but this is something that came up as I was digging through all these junky old records that nobody wanted. I kept noticing recordings, some recordings of birds themselves, which I thought was interesting, and some recordings of people imitating birds. And I thought, well, any case where you have human beings imitating animals and then making records of it and selling the records and listening to the records, well, that's interesting to me. What's this all about? You know, what are these records? So over time, I began to learn some of these stories, and that's what I get to do now, is to share some of what I learned and play you some of these cool old records. I'll begin by reading to you a passage from a book written by a guy named Royal Dixon just 100 years ago, 1917 it was published. It's called The Human Side of Birds. And it describes some of the feeling of the imperative of listening to bird song, the drive to share something that is so easily accessible and so underappreciated and mysterious and not part of our shared culture that we talk about and enjoy and appreciate and pay money for at record stores and concerts and conferences and theater performances. So he says, "It is strange indeed that so few human beings are yet aware of the divine psalmistry of the birds. We pay large sums of money to hear concert music, and we never stop to think that the pieces are only the musician's ideal of some aspect of nature. In his complex civilization, man has grown away from accord with the world of wild things, and he cannot give its essence so truly as his feathered brothers of the air. Birds render in their music the glorious spirit of the universe as it really is and always will be. The indifference of a large part of the human race to the natural beauty that is everywhere reminds one of Stevenson's apt words, 'If God would charge so much a head for sunsets, or send around a drum at the blossoming of hawthorns, perhaps then man would better appreciate and adore what has been his neglected heritage since first his race began.'" The relationship between human beings and birds and music making or sound making is unbelievably old, apparently. I only know a few people who do bird imitation that I've met in life, or any animal imitation. And most of them do it because they were taught by their fathers as part of hunting. Probably preceding anything we would call music or language, people could make sounds in imitation of nature for various reasons. some of them practical. And then at some point, when was it? And was it as important a moment as the building fire or building the first wheel, that somebody came back from the hunt and said to his friend, or indicated, that thing you did, that sound you made when you did the bird, do that again, show everybody. Show how good you are at that. You're really good at that. At what point did it stop being practical and start being entertaining to imitate sounds from nature? I don't know. It's impossible to tell. No one has even speculated on the subject or idea, as far as I know. The oldest musical instrument that we have yet found is 40,000 years old. It was found in 2008 in a cave in southern Germany. It is a flute with three holes bored into it, and it'll play a pentatonic scale, for instance. But it is made from the bone of a bird. So, oldest musical instrument made actually from part of an animal that we think of as being highly musical. Jump cut ahead, 15,000 years BCE, the cave paintings at Lascaux have a painting of a man with a bird's head or a bird mask. Jump cut forward, 1414 BCE, The Birds by Aristophanes, one of the first comedies, includes text transcriptions, the earliest that I know of, text transcriptions, certainly in the oldest in Western culture, of bird song, in this case a hoopoe who says, epoi poi poi, papoi, epoi poi, poi poi, tio 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 tio, trutio trutio, toto brix, toro 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 tix, kikobau kikobau, etc. A few years after that, the first automaton is designed by Archytas, who is a political leader and philosopher. He drew a diagram of a wooden dove that he proposed that would, through a series of strings and pulleys, cantilevers, and small pipes, would be able to not only flap its wings, but would be able to make dove-like sound. It is the first robot human beings ever created. The first lifelike man-made object ever proposed was a bird. It was republished about 500 years later, first century AD in Alexandria in a book called Pneumatica, and those devices were actually built. So the first robots humans made, the first lifelike devices were birds. Bird automata were popular in Italy in the Renaissance and the gardens of nobility. It's a symbol of man's dominion over nature. Dante includes in the Purgatory a line that translates to English as, "Lord, I fear thee no more." But in Latin, it is onomatopoeia. It is the sound of a blackbird singing in spring too early, in February, already singing to encourage the spring along, as like a fool, like an idiot. So the line itself has at least three meanings. These kinds of language things, these automatopoeia, in Britain, for instance, there's a bird that's supposed to say a little bit of bread and no cheese. Probably there are such things in German and French as well. In America, we have birds called whippoorwills. That's the sound the bird makes. The cuckoo, I guess, is the sound that bird makes. These kinds of things have entered into our language, and they are from our interpretation of bird song. We began to transcribe bird song into staff notation in 1650. Athanasius Kirchner in Germany, who was a polymath, first transcribed the songs of nightingales, cuckoos, and quails in one of his books. And that tradition continued for several hundred years. There are many, many hundreds of examples of people transcribing not only bird song, but also rivers, streams. There are staff notation transcriptions of how to play the sound of a stream on a piano or some such instrument. In 1717, there was a book published in England of songs, not that birds sing, but to teach birds to sing. It was called The Bird Fancier's Delight, or Choice Observations with Directions Concerning Ye Teaching of All Sorts of Singing Birds, with Lessons Properly Composed with Ye Compass and Faculty of Each Bird. And it was supposed to have songs in it that you could teach 43 of them to bullfinches, canaries, linnets, woodlarks, skylarks, starlings, sparrows, throstles, and mynas. It was a scam. It was a fraud. It was a late-night infomercial selling you a product that couldn't possibly work. All of the songs were much too complicated to teach your bird. But the public believed that such a thing would be possible because woodsmen would actually go into the forest and gather particular birds. Bullfinches are very good. Bullfinches have a very boring song. The ornithologist Tim Burkhead has described their song, which goes like as like a squeaky wheelbarrow. It's very boring. But they can learn like three or four melodies if you teach it 10 times a day. If you whistle to it and it falls in love with you and cares about you, it will whistle back to you. And like a child, if it gets it wrong, it'll start from the beginning and try again. So the public knew that it was possible for birds to learn songs like this. Queen Victoria bought a four-song bullfinch for many thousands of dollars. Very expensive piece of technology. A high status thing to have a bullfinch that could sing four human-composed melodies. So we made them into little recording devices. In fact, in America, the instrument that children are given to learn to play on first is called a recorder, a block flute, a flageolet. The reason it's called a recorder is that's the instrument that was used to record songs in the minds of birds. It is not well, did not know that as a child, and no one in America I've spoken with knows this. So anyway, then about, let's see, 1810, J.M. Bechstein publishes a book called The Natural History of Cage Birds, Their Management, Habits, Food, Diseases, Treatment, Breeding, and Methods of Catching Them, in which he talks a great deal about all of the surrounding culture of getting and keeping cage birds, which people have been doing for many, many hundreds of years, thousands of years. You have a bird around the house. In the days before radio, before records, before you had something to play music for you around the house, you had a little musical companion. Somebody who would sing to you, a little buddy. Nightingales were far and away the preeminent songbird for much of the world. They are superb singers. Do you have them here? You must. Sometimes, nightingales?
Yeah, okay, good.
We don't. In the Americas, there are no nightingales. There are no nightingales in Australia. But they exist from England, all through Europe, through North Africa, down through Anatolia, the Middle East, Central Asia, India, and down into Indonesia. Huge swath of the world has nightingales. And nightingales will sing all night long, is why they're called that in English. And they are incredibly inventive. They will pour out endless variations of melody, very, very complex, like little Ornette Coleman's and Charlie Parker's, Mozart, the kind of creature that just comes up with new material constantly. And they do this sort of in Europe from about the middle of April for about 2 months. They arrive in Europe, the males arrive about a week before the females, and then the females arrive and they're really singing like crazy. And then there's the courtship phase and mating, and then the eggs are hatched, and then they stop singing about the time the eggs hatch. This is when you need to catch them. You need to catch them before they've paired, but not quite when they're deeply in love. Otherwise, they will go mute and will die of heartbreak. It's not worth it.
Yeah.
But oh yes, okay, good. So this J.M. Bechstein in Germany says that he here transcribes the song of a fine nightingale, without including its delicate little variations, for among these, as among other musicians, there are many great performers, but many more middling ones. This song, this song is so articulate, so speaking, that it may be very well written. The following is a trial which I've made on that of a nightingale in my neighborhood, which passes for a very capital singer. In other words, this is a bird in his neighborhood that he knew well and recognized as being a particularly talented musician. And this is his text transcription of that particular bird's song. It goes. Tio, 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 spatio, squaw. Tio, 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 tix. Cotio, 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 squaw, 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 squaw. Zoot, 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 zee. Cordo, tio, squaw, peepee, queep. Zozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozozoz So why would a record of a bird have sold so well? There are a number of reasons. Number one, first of all, by the way, I neglected to mention earlier, we're all packed in here pretty good. And it's very important to me, you all should be comfortable. So please feel free to get up and get water or the toilet's back there, go smoke a cigarette, like whatever you need to be comfortable, do that. Like that's very important. You won't bother me, okay? All right, so it's just wanted to let you know. All right, so when people begin to have record players in their homes, begin to have gramophones, there is the impulse at first, you know, they're sort of treated like toys. And then gradually as they gain status, more serious musicians begin recording for the record companies. Caruso was the big change. Now we've got a really serious artist to listen to at home that you couldn't afford to go see in person or who you only knew by reputation. They began to accumulate, just like with books, you know, there are all these editions of fine literature with nice spines and gilt, you know, and it demonstrates that you have class, that you have taste, that you're a person of refinement and you like to have nice things around your house, right? So recordings of something as beautiful as a nightingale would fit into that self-image of I'm a person who likes beautiful things and nightingales are beautiful, therefore this, you know, is part of my home and domestic life. We've all encountered people with vast classical music record collections, which they barely listen to. You know, every record is in completely perfect condition because they bought them to look like, you know, I have good taste and I have access to all of this great, important music. You know, and the fact is, you know, what comes out at the parties and what actually gets worn out are the down-home fun records. Anyway, another reason they sold really, really well is that, like I said, nightingales don't exist in the Americas, don't exist in Australia, New Zealand. So for thousands of years, poets have written about nightingales as the perfect metaphor for the best kind of poet, the best kind of musician, the most impassioned lover, the one who cannot help but pour forth and express his devotion. So from Sappho to Homer, Byron, Shelley, Keats, Rumi, Hafez, massive body of literature referencing the Bible. I think four references to the nightingale in the Bible. So all these people who didn't live where there were nightingales now have access to be able to hear for the first time what nightingales sound like. So the music is the sound is able to travel mechanically. It's kind of an interesting thing. And in 1924, there was an orchestral piece composed by Respighi in Italy called The Pines of Rome, kind of programmatic classical stuff of the time. And it's notable, though, as the very first concert piece of music that includes a pre-recorded sound in it. The first time you ever have a high-class piece of concert music where there's a gramophone in the orchestra and the needle has to get put onto a disc at a certain point, actually between the third and fourth movements. There's an instruction in the score that calls for a record to be played. That record is called for by catalog number, and that catalog number is the record we just listened to. Now, if you listen to the Pines of Rome in any modern recording, there have been hundreds and hundreds of them made, they'll always play a recording of a nightingale. None of them play the right one. This is the right one, as it's called for in the actual catalog number. So that's what should be played in that part. And many editions of the score, all editions of the score, include the catalog number of that piece. But many of them, actually, when you would buy the score, it would come with a copy of the record. It's another reason it's so common. Anyway, it's a very good record. I'm going to play you also a recording of a bird that kind of replaced the nightingale in Europe as the preeminent caged bird in people's homes. And those are canaries. There are several reasons why canaries became more popular than the nightingales. The most prosaic of them is that nightingales eat live food and their shit is wet. So they're a pain. You have to clean up after them. And when you catch them, what you do is you get a wine glass and you break off the stem And under the wine glass, you put some live grubs or worms, and then you surround it with chopped up meat, bull heart, I think was the main choice. And the nightingale will peck away at the wine glass trying to get at the worms, but it'll get some of the meat in its mouth, and eventually, hopefully, it will decide, well, this is fine, I can live on this. And then you've got a bird that will live with you for 15, 25 years, hopefully. Canaries are much easier to deal with. They have an amazing song, but they are tropical. They're from a group of islands, the Canary Islands, they're named after. The islands, by the way, are named after the wild dogs that roam the island in packs, Canaris in Latin. So the birds are named after the islands, are named after the dogs. It just so happens. Spain owned these islands at the 15th century, and they began to gather these birds and bring them in, and they were very trainable. So the royalty of Spain and then France and then England and Germany began to employ people specially to take care of their canary collections and to breed them and to have nice ones that looked pretty and that sounded the best. Over several hundred years, by exposing young birds during the first 120 days of their life to older birds whose songs you particularly like, you can develop a strain of bird that sings the kind of sound that you particularly like. So, by Darwin's time, he had noticed that captive canary song bore almost no resemblance at all to wild canary song. It is true now that captive canary song is a human composition. We made that over hundreds of years. And there's a long tradition of it, that there's a lexicon, a vocabulary for the elements of canary song, much of which is German, schockels and bells and tours and rolls and pipes, the various elements that make up good canary song. In fact, right now in Baltimore, this is the time of year when the two canary song breeding associations of my city of 600,000 people are having their annual competitions at a Best Western motel, where for 13 hours, one woman who wears gray sweatpants and for decades ago forgot about her appearance, but lives inside her ears and her head, sits and judges one fleet of bird after the other and listens to them and decides who are the best among them. The values of the birds, based on her decisions and her criteria, will fluctuate vastly. If she decides someone is a very good singer and it appeals to her ear, everybody greatly respects her. Everybody knows that she really has a great ear for canary song. She does. I sat with her for about 4 hours a couple of years ago, and it was extraordinary. I came out with new ears. But it's an ongoing tradition. It was by the beginning of the 16th century in France when Monsieur Bernard had invented an instrument, a barrel organ called a serenet, which was specifically designed to train canaries to sing a particular way. We'll be hearing a different version of that same impulse a little later. In English, canaries are what color? Canaries are yellow, we always say. Canary yellow is the color of the Ferrari that Miles Davis drove or whatever. Canaries are not yellow. Canaries are green. All of them are green in the wild. We made them yellow. And then we made them white. And then, in the 1920s, after a couple of hundred years of people trying, Karl Reich, the man who recorded that nightingale song, he and his partner, Dunnerk or something, produced the first canary that could turn red, the red factor canary. They did it by creating the first genetically modified animal ever. They spliced in the genes of a red siskind from South America, a bird that a canary would never have contact with in the wild, and they created the first red canaries in the 1920s in Germany. So I'm going to play for you now a recording of a German canary aviary in 1937, owned by one F. Blanc, about whom we know nothing. This is not a recording of nature in any sense whatsoever. This is not wild sound. This is a human composition made for other people who are already cognoscenti, who are already trained in listening to and appreciating good canary song. This is an especially great example of a particular kind of human music making using animals as the devices through which the song is produced. Now, when the lady in Baltimore is judging the fleets of canaries, what she's looking for first and foremost, beyond tone, beyond variation, she's mainly looking for Beethoven himself. She is looking for the bird who must sing, who immediately bursts forth, who cannot help but sing. That's what you want more than anything. The one who, for mysterious reasons, while the others are freaked out by moving into a new room, or the light is different, or they just don't feel like it for whatever reason, physically, they just don't feel like singing that. The one who can't help but sing, that's the best. That's the best bird. So to have a bunch of them, and for them to have good tone, is a kind of a special accomplishment. And that's what we'll be listening to now. Again, Berlin, 1937. This is a gramophone record you could go into somebody's house and hear them playing. Now, I'm not the first person that has noticed that aesthetically, that particular recording seems to bear some resemblance, for instance, to some of the German electronic music that was produced maybe about 25 years later, Stockhausen and such. Coincidence? No idea. No one else seems to have asked the question or looked into whether this kind of aesthetic world of sound had any bearing on anything else that that came along afterward, but it's interesting to listen to, and it's a pretty hot little record. So there were Canary competitions for song, for appearance, and not just song in the sense of tone and beauty and pleasantness, but also for the one aesthetic criteria we know that female birds have for male singers, which is stamina. There's a lot of neurological research being done now. What is it that female birds like about male bird song? And we don't know, is the short answer. There's no particular reason for a lot of male bird song to be as elaborate and beautiful as it is that we've yet found. We do know that females do like stamina, a bird that can go a long time, and you know, it indicates good health. You know, a good physical specimen who will create then good healthy babies, theoretically. But in canary competitions in Darwin's time, he went, for instance, to smoky bars, taverns in London, and saw canary singing competitions where guys were getting together and getting drunk, smoking cigarettes, avoiding their wives and children, as men do, and you know, going out and showing off their collections, as record collectors, for instance, will do. And in this case, having the birds sing against each other for raw stamina. And so the birds would actually sing oftentimes until one burst a blood vessel in his lungs. I've known some musicians who were also similar in this way. Tim Burkhead, this English ornithologist, says that we know that there were already yellow canaries having been bred in England by William Hogarth's day in the early 1700s. At this time, England was a country of pickpockets, press gangs, wig-wearing workers, urban filth, rural poor, child chimney sweeps, slaves, grave robbers, public hangings, gin mania, Fanny Hill, and rickets, as well as enthusiastic bird keepers. There were at the time an estimated 200,000 canaries in London alone. It was a massive thing. Most of them came from the Harz Mountains of Germany. There were entire towns where three quarters of the families made their livings breeding canaries for generations and generations. The birds went mainly to export. Largely to England, some to France. Others went to various parts of the world. In Japan, they were highly prized. And they were so cheap and common in that part of Germany that that's where silver miners began to take the birds down in little cages to test the air to see, you know, the canaries' metabolism running faster would, if there were noxious gases in the mines, the canaries would fall over or die, and you would go, uh-oh, we need to get out of here. Thus the phrase, the canary in the coal mine. So that's where that's from. It's from the fact that so many canaries were being produced as a item, as goods, in that particular part of the world. Like I said, 1630, Monsieur Bernard in France produces this instrument for training canaries to sing called a serenette. And just as we used recording devices to capture and share and appreciate bird song, we also used recording devices fairly quickly to train birds. So the one we just listened to, that was a commercial record you could go into a shop and buy. It was one of these. It was a commercial bought and sold thing. What I'm going to play for you next is not that. It's from 1922, and it's a privately produced recording that was made in a recording laboratory in the US in Indiana called Jennett Studios. I don't know if there are any heavy-duty jazz or blues fans here, but Jennett Records is where a lot of the best early jazz was recorded. In Richmond, Indiana, 1922, Jelly Roll Morton, I think, did sessions in the same studio at the same time. It was, in fact, a subsidiary of a furniture company. The Star Furniture Company sold gramophones, you know, these big, beautiful cabinets, and then as a sideline, they also produced records cheaply in order to sell you something to play on your gramophone. Anyway, so at Jennett Studios, this record was produced for a Canary Breeders Association in Kentucky, and it's a human performance. It's two human beings playing. One is playing a flute, and the other is playing a what's described on the label as a water organ. Now, I believe that this water organ is a device that has pipes with a reservoir at the bottom, and air is blown over the surface of water, which is in the reservoir, and it produces a fluttering sound. I've never seen one, and I assume it was custom built for this purpose. But
isn't that instrument also playing by the 13th first floor? That psychedelic band?
No, no, that's a jug. It's a jug.
Is it similar to that?
No. No, there's no water in the jug, and he's actually making that sound into the jug and then amplifying it with the microphones. I believe that that style of his playing, Tommy Hall's style, is derived mainly from the bongo playing on the song A Hard Day's Night. If you listen to A Hard Day's Night, it has that same all the way through it. I believe that's the same aesthetic criteria that's used in all those Elevator songs. They're my favorite rock and roll band of all time, the Elevators. Anyway. Would you please pass it to me? Right. It's just behind you. There's a little clay. Would you run it under some water just for a second? Just pour some water into the hole in the top until it's full. Exactly, yes. I didn't know about this, and that's why I believe that that's how this organ is constructed, is because of this thing. I happened to find this at a market in Bucharest, Romania, and I thought that it was, you know, quite an amazing, very exotic. So it's, what he's talking about is one of these. So this is a little whistle with water in it. And like that, right? Yeah, that's what you mean.
Yeah, it's a library for kids.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. There's a bunch of different varieties. There's slide whistle ones, and yeah, I want to buy them all. I was so bummed out when I went home and I looked on Amazon, and you can buy these for 75 cents. I didn't need to keep it carefully wrapped up all the way from Romania at all. There was no reason for me to be so precious about it. Anyway, yeah, so this record we're about to listen to. Okay, first of all, the record is worn out. I'm only going to play about a minute of it because it's destroyed, because somebody played it hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times, probably using, you know, the old wind-up gramophone machines, where it's a steel spike that is pounds of pressure per square inch on a disc that is made of a combination of ground stone and shellac, which is an insect secretion from South Asia. People climb trees, scrape off this bug goo that the lac beetle emits between larval and pupal stages. They scrape it off and they melt it down, and then they use it to do, for furniture finishing. Candy used to be covered in this stuff, this insect goo, and they mixed it with ground stone and carbon black and a little bit of cotton fiber, and they used it to press 78 RPM discs. So the discs were made of this proto-plastic, this organic proto-plastic and stone, and all of this weight. A modern record player is grams of pressure per square inch. Pounds of pressure per square inch on a steel spike. So the record wore out, is what happened. So I did a lot of work on restoring this. I'll play you just a minute of it so you hear. I think this is a record made for a canary audience. So think of yourselves as canaries. So this was privately distributed within a canary breeding association to be played for birds. It's the only copy I've ever seen or heard of. But already, it's us imitating animals to imitate us using a mechanical device to do so. So, you know, kind of neat. Now, when the record companies began, they began recording canary song, or beg your pardon, they began recording human beings imitating birds very quickly. The gramophone company started in Washington, D.C. about 1890. They start putting out records in large quantities. 1896, they released the first recording of animal imitation. It was made by, let's see here, I always forget this guy's name, N.R. Wood. February 15th, 1896, he records it for the first time. It's about 10 years after the very first recordings of anything were ever made. It was called Morning on the Farm. He recorded it six times because the deal was, in the early days of making records, the parts you would use to make multiple copies, stampers, would wear out fast. So you could only make a few dozen copies or 100 copies, and then you'd have to have the artist come back in and do the performance over again and re-record it and make a new stamper set and then, you know, make more duplicates from that. So a big hit record, you'd have to have them come in and re-record the record many, many times. He wound up recording this one six times, so it sold pretty well. The record company distributed a paragraph of promotional advertising describing what the record sounded like and why you would want to own it. It says, "It's a realistic farmyard scene illustrating all the different sounds attending the early morning rising on the farm. This reproduction clearly and accurately brings out the bleating of sheep, the lowing of cattle, the crowing of the cock, the cackle of the hens, the squeal of the guinea hen, and the gobble of the turkey, all being answered by the cries of the neighboring hawk, crow, and other birds. So real is the arrangement, and so exact the imitation, that it requires but a slight stretch of the imagination to place oneself in that delightful position, the result of which is the drinking in of copious draughts of fresh air and numerous other pleasurables attainable only on the farm." That's what you get for your money. You get to feel like you're on a farm by the sound of somebody imitating the kinds of sounds you would have heard on a farm. Pretty good. It sold. It did well. They recorded another record in 2 years later by one Milton M. Clark, simply titled Imitation of Birds, March 1898. About 2 minutes of performance. I've never seen or heard of a copy. I'd love to find one. But as far as I know, that's the first specific bird imitation record. It did not sell well. But then when the record companies begin running all over the earth, recording all kinds of music from people in Burma and Turkey and Russia and Italy and Egypt and Ireland and all over the place, trying to sell record players to people first and foremost, they recorded the sound of the music they thought people would want to hear in their own homes so people would buy record players. One of the things they recorded consistently all over the world was bird imitation. So in India, for instance, the first recording of bird imitation was made, let me see, by Venugopalachari, 1908, 2 years after recording begins in India. There's already recordings of bird imitation. I'll play you one that was made in 1920. This is by a guy named Abdul Wahid and his theatrical troupe. This is what they did for a living as they went around entertaining people by imitating various things, not just birds, but also car horns and other things.
Hazrat, zara gaur se suniyega. Ye insaan hokar parindon ki boli kis sifat ke saath suna raha hai. Achha beta. मौसम बहार में कोयल दरख्तों पर क्यों कर चहचहाती है अच्छा बेटा मुर्गी अंडे देकर अपनी कोठरी से कड़कड़ाती हुई क्यों कर बाहर निकलती है Ha 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 बेटा बेटा मुर्गा सुबह को क्यों कर बांग देता है? अच्छा बेटा मच्छर शाम के वक्त किस तरह फन भलाती है? अच्छा बेटा उल्लू का तुम फाख्ता जरा फाख्ता बन जा।
So, okay, to compare and contrast, here's another musical theater performer doing bird imitation professionally. This is one, Monsieur Alexandre, at the Alhambra Theater in Paris, about 1909, 1908, thereabouts.
Quelques imitations de chants d'oiseaux. Voici d'abord le réveil de la vulgaire pierrot. La cale. Le poisson. Le canari poisson. Le merle.
So what I'm trying to say is that this is a thing that went on all over the world. It was an evening's entertainment. It was part of an evening's entertainment. If you were going to a variety show, a theatrical performance, this might be one of the things that you would see, is a person would come out on stage and the sound of a bird or animal would come out of them. Now, that experience is wonderful because it is dissociative, because for however many thousands of years, human beings from infancy are trained to understand that a sound you hear is associated with a thing you can see. And when you see a person with the sound of an animal coming out of it, well, it's just kind of amazing. Now, this was the case in the early days of recording with record players. When people first encountered record players, that was their first experience, was dissociative wonder. If your eyes were to be believed, there was no person singing. There was no piano player. And yet, here's the sound of a person singing or a piano player. It was amazing. It wound up undermining the whole genre of imitation performance. Bird imitation was so popular that it had to be recorded because some of these people were big celebrities and their names would instantly sell the records. But the records themselves take away one of the main levels of appreciation of the art, which is the fact of seeing something that is sounds like it's different from what you're seeing, right? Okay, but in the US, there was a major rise in whistling generally and bird imitation in particular at the end of the 19th and beginning of the 20th century as a feminist movement, along with the development of the suffragette movement, whistling goes along with it. There are dozens, hundreds of newspaper articles that I've found in the US from that period, end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th century, that all begin with a little couplet that apparently everybody knew at the time that goes, a whistling woman and a crowing hen never will come to any good end. And then the article would go on to say from there, and we all know this, we all have heard this before, but nowadays, we live in modern times, and guess what, folks? There's a woman coming to our town, she's gonna be at the church tonight, she's gonna get up in front of God and everyone and whistle. Can you believe it? Modern times, a woman whistling in public. Amazing. So for instance, an article, the San Francisco Chronicle, 26th of June, 1904, titled, Whistling as an Art is Drawing Pretty Lips to a Pucker, which began with a little poem that says, boys may whistle, but girls must sing. Now I call that a curious thing. If boys can whistle, why can't girls too? It's the easiest thing in the world to do. So it was a movement. There were, well, many, many articles written by important, serious doctors in the press, advising people that it was perfectly okay physically for women to whistle. Don't worry, it will do no permanent lasting damage to your daughter if she whistles. Hand to God. For instance, Dr. L.K. Hirschberg, A.B., M.A., M.D. of Johns Hopkins, in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, April 1905, says, the hygienic advantage of whistling is only beginning to be recognized by psychologists and public health officials. Most medical men, however, especially of the strict laboratory kind, scoff at the very idea of it. Yet, as an aid to health, whistling is equal to most muscular exercises and far superior to most medicines and baths and morbid medicamentations. Thanks, Doc. It's science, folks. It's perfectly fine. And as a result, there were, that I know of so far, at least six schools of artistic whistling founded in the United States, attended entirely by women. The most important of which was Agnes Woodward's California School of Artistic Whistling, which graduated two very important people. Number one is a whistler that every single person in this room has heard. Marion Darlington is her name, and I wouldn't remember her name either unless I had it written down in front of me, to tell you the truth. Marion Darlington is the whistler in the first five Disney feature films. So when Snow White goes to the wishing well and sings, I'm wishing, and the bird whistles the tune back to her, that's Marion Darlington, a graduate of Agnes Woodward's California School of Artistic Whistling. Which, by the way, if you're gonna go to art school, seems like one to recommend, as far as I'm concerned. I don't recall the dates and I don't have them with me, but it must have been around 1910, somewhere in there. She published a book, which is available for free online, in 1937. She published a book, I think, called The Art of Whistling. Half of it is on bird imitation. The other half is on whistling tunes more generally. But it's at archive.org. Agnes Woodward is her name. It's a really good book. But her other most famous student was a woman named Margaret McKee. Margaret McKee was from Southern California, born 1898, died 1960. She started performing as a whistler at the age of nine, attended Agnes Woodward's school, and then performed 1915 to 1918 around various theaters and kind of edutainment evenings. Evenings like this. There was a movement in America of what were called Chautauqua performances. It was like high class vaudeville. It was vaudeville that made you feel good about yourself for having supposedly learned something or improved your soul in some way. Like watching a documentary on television, you know, you think you're learning something, but in fact you're mostly being sort of entertained and whiling away the time. Like this. Women would get dressed in togas and do tableaus from Greek and Roman sculpture, and guys would get dressed up as Abraham Lincoln and give his speeches, and somebody would give a lecture on temperance, and there'd be, you know, a musician or a whistler, an animal imitator. So Margaret McKee was giving Chautauqua kind of performances. And then she toured Europe for 4 years, 1922 to 26. She was noticed, in fact, by Sarah Bernhardt, the Belgian actress, and who noted that Margaret McKee may be one of the greatest performers living at the time. She was, in fact, a great virtuoso. In 1929, she struck up with a Baptist evangelist preacher in Brooklyn, a guy who had a storefront church and gave biweekly sermons on subjects like the virtuous life and suicide. Is it ever justifiable? But every Wednesday and Sunday night before his sermons, Margaret McKee would get up and do a whistling performance as part of the draw to get people to come in and listen. Things between them didn't work out, apparently. She moved back to California with her maiden name and continued whistling for another 20 years, mostly at ladies' functions, teas, and social gatherings. But here she is at the peak of her popularity, about 1928. She's a superb virtuoso performer, one of my favorites. This is Bird Imitations by Margaret McKee, the great.
A few bird imitations, beginning with the meadow lark. Song Sparrow. The Red-Winged Blackbird. The plump little California quail. The linnet. The cardinal red bird. Our home canary. The mockingbird who can imitate them all.
So there are good whistlers, there are great whistlers, and then there's Charles Kellogg, who is in a league of his own and who I'll play you in a moment. But first I want to tell you a little bit about the life of this extraordinary person who made a spectacular career that lasted over 50 years, traveling around, giving lectures, and doing animal imitation. Charles Kellogg was born in the Sierra Nevada Mountains in Northern California in 1868. He grew up 200 miles from a railroad. His father ran a store for the gold miners who'd come in the gold rush. His mother was lost. I don't know what that means, but he says she was gone when he was 2 or 3 years old. Maybe she died, maybe she left, don't know. But his father basically gave him over to a Chinese woman and an American Indian guy to raise. And he spent most of his childhood alone in the woods. He said lonely but not unhappy. He heard very little English, but he spent all his time out in the woods hanging out with the animals, listening to them and speaking back to them in their own languages. Bears, snakes, insects, birds. About 11 or 12 years old, his father decides something needs to be done about the boy. And he sends Charles off to live with wealthy relatives in upstate New York. Charles learns to do woodworking. He becomes a regular kid, attends Syracuse University, where he founds a men's choir. He likes singing. And he gets up at a Chautauqua evening there in upstate New York, about the age of 20 or 21 years old. And he does this thing that he learned how to do as a child that he has just now realized other people don't know how to do, which is to sing through his throat like an animal, to make animal sounds. People go crazy. So he's really good at it. He's really good. And he realizes he's onto something, and he hits the road, and he becomes a performer. He continues to perform for almost 20 years before he has his big break. He has honed and refined by traveling all over the place, from Alaska to Cuba. He founded a camp in Maine, spent a lot of time in California. I mean, he was all over North America, studying, listening, and performing like crazy, many, many months of the year. And he developed a persona and a message that he would give in these performances. He would go also, like me, he's a talker. Performances were 2 hours sometimes. By the time he'd reached his real peak, about 1910, the performance went like this. There was a painted backdrop on the stage of the woods. He comes out of the stage dressed as a woodsman. He's really good looking. He's got a mustache. He looks like a Brooklyn hipster, basically. He's like a really nice looking, well put together guy. And his mouth is closed, but he is emitting from his nose birdsong through his voice, his larynx. He claimed to actually have been physically born with a bird syrinx, a separate kind of vocal apparatus, which allowed him to sing like birds. Bullshit. So a lot of what he said was bullshit. But it got people's attention, and people really just didn't know any better. I mean, he also demonstrated that you could rub two sticks together and make fire. People didn't know that either. You know, that was amazing to people. This is before the Boy Scouts. This is before, like, a naturalist movement where people went back to nature. He was at the vanguard of this mediating nature for people on stage in cities, right? So, comes out on stage, his bird songs are coming out of him. And then he begins to speak to the audience, ladies and gentlemen, I've lived my life in the woods, and I am in touch with nature. I love the animals, and they love me, and it's all about love. We exchange vibratory information, and he goes on like this for a while. And then he says, and I can clearly demonstrate these vibratory manifestations, and he lights a gas burner. He's got pressurized gas and a flame in a glass tube. And now, ladies and gentlemen, this blade of flame will dance with the vibrations I will emit through the sound of my song. And he would do these high birdsong type tones, claiming to have a 9.5 octave vocal range, vastly larger than a Bösendorfer grand imperial piano. And he would make the flame dance. Now, apparently he had gotten his hands on a copy, an early English language edition of Hermann Helmholtz's book on the sensations of tone, a physical acoustics book which demonstrates that the air is a medium in which vibration flows and that, you know, such things. People didn't know this. They thought of air as being empty space. So he's showing this to audiences and they're freaking out. Like, wow, he's really doing that. And then the big closer of the show, he emits a tone, he puts the flame out, extinguishes the flame. The crowd goes crazy, right? So his first big break in the press happens December 4th, 1910. The San Francisco Call publishes an article called Charles Kellogg, the Man Who Sings with Birds in His Own Language. The writer says, he has the utmost faith in the power of love and kindness. It is all love, he says. Anybody who goes to the woods with the spirit of love in his heart, without the faintest desire for destruction or possession, can make friends with the birds if he's merely tactful and patient. Birds can read the heart of men better than men can. They know their friends and are ready to love them. In Kellogg's mind, there is no place for hatred. Fear creates fear. Hatred breeds hatred. Love engenders love. These are the cardinal tenets of Kellogg's creed. And that was his message throughout the rest of his life. He was a vegetarian. He never took a gun into the woods with him. Although, you know, it's said among his family, apparently, that although he was vegetarian, he loved to pour on the gravy. Which is also a metaphor for how, you know, deeply attention-hungry he was and how well he manipulated the press. As he would fall out of favor, he would come up with some new fantastic thing, take photographs of it, send it off to the newspapers, and they would just run it as is, basically, you know. For instance, he cut a 22-foot section of a fallen redwood log from the Great Redwood Forest in California, and he got two axemen, and they carved out the inside of it with tables, chairs, benches, seats, cabinets, and he mounted it on the chassis of a tank about late 20s, early 30s. And then he drove this thing around, giving tours where he would, whistle-stop tours, if you'll pardon the pun, where he would talk about nature and how important nature is. And oh, by the way, I'm Charles Kellogg, the great nature singer. You may have heard my records. He made dozens of records for the Victor Company in New Jersey. We'll be listening to one momentarily. Don't worry, I'm not going to talk forever. You know, here's me, I'm great. And by the way, check out this incredible thing I made demonstrating, you know, showing you the forest. I'm bringing the forest to you. And he called it the travel log. Har, har, har. So he was good with the press. And he was making crazy money. In 1915, he was making $4,000 a week at the big theater in Chicago. It's the modern equivalent of $100,000 a week, right? He got insanely Oprah Winfrey level rich, multi-millionaire from this thing he learned to do as a kid out in the woods. All right, there's more to say about Charles Kellogg, but I'll give you some of his own talking and performance here so you can get a better idea. Now again, some of this is what we would call whistled. A lot of it, though, takes place in his throat.
Most people who listen to the singing of songbird songs fail to notice that all songbirds sing in the ecstatic mood and not in the lyrics. A good example is that of the catbird. Or Mother Carey's chicken is heard from out of the fog. The first bird voice that greets me in the spring of the year is the cardinal redbird calling, "What cheer, what cheer, what cheer?" Ending with a loud call. The pert Jenny Wren, or house wren, pours out its voice in undulating trills. The tremulous, hysterical, sobbing call of the loon can only be heard at its best from over the lake on a moonlight night. Of the marsh is the ocallee call of the red-winged blackbird. Notice the cluck. The jerky, jingling song of the bobolink is usually given in one breath, ending with a clear whistle entirely distinct from the song. Among the numerous calls of the quail, the California mountain quail is distinctive and readily recognized. Whistle beard, whistle beard, whistle beard.
With easy play upon one's imagination, the language of the birds of the marsh can almost be understood. As I approach, the old bird on guard will seem to say, "Watch out, watch out.
Watch out, watch out, watch out."
Another one on the other side of the marsh will say, "What for, what for?
Watch for, watch for, watch for."
Another will say, "Well, well, well.
Well, 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 well."
One more bold will say, "Come over here, come over here.
Come over here. Come over here, come over here."
While a timid Grobeck will say, "I want to come home, I want to come home.
I want to come home, I want to come home."
They all jabber together. Finally, they will all sing the chorus together. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up.
Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up.
No, it was, yeah, it's waterfowl that he's imitating. But I mean, that's actually, it's him doing all those sounds, of course. But oh, yes, so that would be some kind of a goose or duck or something, I think. Yes, I'm not really sure. At that point in the performance, it sort of stops mattering to me. I'm just sort of enjoying what a weirdo he is. So that was almost exactly 100 years ago. It was 1916. Around that time, he was also doing performances where he would get 6 gramophones on stage and then put on records of himself doing bird imitation on each of the record players and put them all on and then do it along with. And then he reproduced that in a recording studio at the same time. And there's a performance of his called Bird Chorus, which is on the cassette that I brought along for sale, by the way, since might as well do some merchandising. There's 7. So he had 2 gramophones playing recordings of himself doing bird imitation while he does bird imitation along with them. And this is the first ever example of overdubbing. It was Charles Kellogg. I don't think anybody else knows that. It's literally not written into the story of, you know, sound reproduction. But it's a very important, interesting moment that it was his own imagination. He was wild. He believed that he could, when radio comes along in the 30s, he's got this great idea. By vibrating tuning forks, by bowing tuning forks, and playing them over the radio, firemen with big speakers will be able to put out flames with sound. This is his idea. Didn't work. But he tried it. You know, it is an interesting person. Okay, so to kind of wind up here a little bit, I'll say that one of the things that happens is 1932, the first recordings of birds are made outside in the field. Arthur Albert at the Cornell Ornithology Lab makes recordings of birds outside on film. Then in 1932, Arthur Brand makes the first recordings using a parabolic microphone, a directional pointed microphone. Just a few years later, Ludwig Koch, who you remember, made the first ever recordings of birds, by then had fled Germany and landed in the UK, where he became a popular radio personality and newspaper writer. He makes the first outdoor recordings of birds in the UK. He incidentally had a beautiful piece in the London Times in 1940 that said, "Bird life is always going on, and the song of the birds continues constantly, and there's nothing that the 3 dictators can do about it. And anyone in a position to do so should try and relax his nerves and listen now to the beautiful song of the birds." Well, I hope you take some comfort in this in the time of Trump. Sorry. Bird song and bird imitation kind of goes from being a very popular musical theater form because of sound reproduction and because of access and the instantaneous ability to get at birdsong. Now the Cornell Ornithology Lab this year has made their entire archives available online, and you can hear recordings of hundreds of thousands, maybe millions, of wild birds from all around the world on their website as of this year. So we have the sense that there is constant access. When there was less access, well, there was more need for this kind of sharing of things in these theatrical settings, right? But it sort of falls back into folklore, which is where it remains. There are bird imitators still. There was one in Italy on a reality talent television show about 10 years ago. I found some clips on YouTube. Guys in Guyana together get together. Suriname, the national sport is competitive bird singing. It is not football. I'd love to go, but the tickets are more expensive than to go to Europe from where I live. But I'll play you one last little thing. This is a recording made for all you folkies. This is a Work Progress Administration recording made for the Library of Congress by Charles L. Todd for the Robert Sorkin Migrant Workers Collection at a Farm Security Administration camp in Arvin, California. This is a recording of a guy named Donald Leach, made August 24th of 1941. Donald Leach was, Donald Leach was 6 years old when he made this recording of various imitations that he had learned to do.
Right turn. Chicken. Turkey.
The point of all this, and there is one, kind of, is that there are stories that we tell ourselves constantly about who we are, what we've done, what we've created, and what it all represents. When you go on a first date, you retell these stories about who you say you are and what you say you've done and what it is you think you've made or created as a person, how you've become yourself, right? It's how memories are constructed, how cultures decide to be cultures and aren't just some amorphous situation of everything that's accumulated, remembered constantly. Life would be unlivable if we didn't edit our memories. However, if you go back into the actual details in the records of what went down, if you have a friend who remembers you back when and remembers things you said and did that you don't remember about yourself, well, the truth of those memories is actually potentially very instructive and could be weirder and more exciting and more fun than the story you've been telling about who you are yourself all the time. And so that's what this whole business of going around and looking at these junky old records nobody wants is. We agree on certain things, but then there's everything else. And within everything else, well, there's all kinds of good fun to be had. And that brought me to Geneva somehow from Baltimore. I don't know how that happened. You're all very patient. Thank you very, very, very much. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Yes. Thanks.